But anyways, I think we're going to have a nice discussion on this topic area. Let me introduce the next speaker, another friend of mine. I've learned a lot from him, Dr. Fergus McBeth, who recently retired from active clinical practice working as an oncologist. He's currently Associate Director of Wales Cancer Trials Unit in Cardiff and Honorary Professor at Cardiff University. Dr. McBeth has worked at the National Institute of Health and Care Excellence, NICE, in the United Kingdom for almost 10 years, a director for cancer guidelines and then director for the Center for Clinical Practice, responsible for wider clinical practice guidelines. He's also been a member of Board of Trustees of the GIN from 2011 to 2014. And he teaches currently at UK Cochrane Centre, Collaboration for Evidence-Based Healthcare in Africa. And he's published widely on several guideline topic areas, but more specifically on lung cancer. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Fergus McBeth.
Thanks very much, Amir. What I'm going to do today is question the term personalized medicine. And first of all, my declarations. If I can find the right thing to move the slides on. I certify, et cetera, I've got no financial declarations of interest. However, I am a persistent and habitual skeptic rather than an enthusiast, and this will probably be reflected in my talk. And I have to confess, this is a personal reflection and not a systematic review. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to explore the meaning of the term personalized medicine, suggest that perhaps it is misleading and oversold, and talk a bit about the implications for clinical guidelines and also on health equity. So, what is personalized medicine? And this is the Personalized Medicine Coalition. It's a coalition of pharmaceutical companies, diagnostic companies, and academic institutions in North America. And this is their definition. It's an evolving field in which physicians use diagnostic tests to determine which medical treatments work best for each patient. Well, that doesn't sound very new to me. Let me take you back 500 years. Okay. Sorry, I'm sticking to my slides. Sorry, that's the previous definition. 500 years. Now, 500 years ago, the Macbeths were hereditary doctors to the clans in the Highlands and Islands of Scotland. And although they were practicing at the sort of northwest fringes of Europe, they were well acquainted with continental standards of practice, and they wrote this textbook in the Gaelic language on healthcare, called Regimen Sanitatis, the rule of health. So this was an early clinical guideline. I mean, I didn't know that there was a genetic factor both in medicine and in guidelines, but there clearly is. And they tailored their interventions to the patient. They looked at the patient's symptoms, very wisely. They looked at their astrological findings, which astrology was probably the MRI scan of the Middle Ages. And they also looked at their age and other factors like that. And they had three interventions. They had herbs, they had diet, and they had bloodletting, venesection. And so they tailored these to the patient. And there were some very wise recommendations that patients with flatulence should not eat beans. Patients over 60 should not have any blood let from them. Perhaps less wise were that patients with headache should have the occipital vein drained of blood, but you know, you can't really. The evidence probably for that was probably poor. So why is, and my own practice as an oncologist for many years, I felt I was practicing personalized medicine, tailoring the clinical decisions to the patient in front of me in the light of the evidence and their preferences. So why is this suddenly something new? Well, it's to do with this. The human genome. The early 2000s, the human genome was finally sequenced, a fantastic triumph of scientific analysis. And after the sequencing, the promise of a revolution in clinical science and practice, summed up by this very optimistic view from the New England Journal of Medicine, just before the sequencing was about to be published, the practice of medicine has now entered an era in which the individual patient's genome will help determine the optimal approach to care genomics, which has quickly emerged as a central basic science of biomedical research, is poised to take center stage in clinical medicine as well. Absolutely fantastic. As that well-known US physician, Dr. Bones McCoy of the US Starship Enterprise might have said, "This is medicine, Jim, but not as we know it." So, 14 years later, where are we? Well, major institutes in North America and Europe have got their departments of personalized medicine, their professorships of personalized medicine springing up all over the place, and there are things like this on the website springing up. This is from the Mayo Clinic. We've provided personalized precision medicine to every one of our patients for over 150 years, but in recent years, advances in genomic and clinical science have created innovative opportunities to further tailor healthcare to each patient. And they've set up this individualized medicine clinic at Mayo. And you can find similar things on other websites from major institutions. I just want to pick up on one phrase in this, and I hadn't realized by doing this I was criticizing President Obama and his use of the term precision medicine. But it worries me, this term precision medicine. It kind of summons up precision bombing, millimeter accuracy, and also the implication that all other medicine is somehow imprecise. But is this anything new? Hasn't the treatment of vitamin deficiency, the treatment of hormone deficiency, the treatment of infection with the most appropriate antibiotic also been precision medicine? And we've had that for decades. This is, I think, a bit of window dressing. And there is also this feeling that this somehow is the death of evidence-based medicine. And there are the critics of evidence-based medicine. You wouldn't believe it, but there are people who criticize the concept of evidence-based medicine and have been doing so for the past 20 years. And they sort of see this as a bit of ammunition for them. You know, their argument has always been that evidence-based medicine is based on randomized trials with the problems of selected patients and average outcomes and ignoring individual characteristics. All of these have got some merit, but evidence-based medicine, we all know, has emphasized right from the beginning about the use of the best available evidence, not just RCTs, and the use of clinical judgment and patient preferences as well. So I don't think the criticisms are justified. But more importantly, is this new thing called personalized medicine or precision medicine, but I would prefer to call genomic medicine, is it really delivering major health gain? I'm going to look at three topics: oncology, pharmacogenomics, and diabetes. And I confess I know a bit about oncology, having been an oncologist. I know relatively little about pharmacogenomics and diabetes, but I've done a little bit of reading and selective Googling. So, as I said, it's not a systematic review. As for oncology, well, cancer medicine is seen as a kind of poster child of genomic medicine, and there have indeed been a few really dramatic developments. And the outlook of the patients with advanced chronic myeloid leukemia, and metastatic malignant melanoma have been transformed by this, by the developments here, and that's undeniable. And we have found that there are an increasing number of what are called druggable mutations and the drugs to go with them. But the disappointing thing is for the common cancers, the changes in outcome have been rather disappointing and short-lived, with two or three exceptions. And the effects are relatively modest. And there is a concern that actually, if you just emphasize this genomic medicine and therapy, you may actually be providing worse outcomes. If you stop giving people well-validated, randomized controlled trial, assured systemic therapy with chemotherapy, if you don't give people that and you give this new medicine instead, you may actually be getting worse outcomes. Sometimes a shotgun is a more effective weapon than a laser-sighted rifle. And it's all obviously becoming much more complicated the more we learn about this. We're learning that cancers evolve, they mutate, they change, and these changes and mutations can be tracked through metastases in single patients. And the pathways that control cancer growth are very complex. You may shut off one pathway with your fantastic medicine, but another pathway opens up. And in addition, there is the whole issue of epigenetics, the things that control the expression of, of DNA through DNA methylation. And people are starting to understand that has huge implications as well. And so just knowing the genomic mutations may not be enough. And I'm not the only skeptic. And here's a recent review in Lancet Oncology from Prasad et al. Those oncologists who practice precision oncology are two steps ahead of the data. And the history of medicine has taught us that is an uncertain place to stand. And Bruce Chabner, who's a very well-known medical oncologist in the US, wrote recently in The Oncologist, underlying this new effort is my conviction that genomic medicine is neither totally precise nor completely rational at this point in its time in its development. So what about pharmacogenomics? We know that there are genetic polymorphisms associated with altered metabolism of a number of drugs, and perhaps the most studied of clopidogrel and warfarin. And it's suggested that knowing the genetic profile of individual patients may lead to more precise dosing. But this review from the BMJ in 2012 showed that no strong evidence of genetically determined dosing giving better outcomes, and that the notion that genetic information is uniquely important in determining risk and benefits of treatments is clearly unwarranted and counterproductive to the broadly shared goal of tailoring care to individuals. Not so hot. And finally, diabetes, and again, extensive research has shown there are a large number of genes that control and contribute to susceptibility both to obesity and to diabetes. And there have been some really significant discoveries of a few rare variants of diabetes determined by a single gene. But again, a recent review said, despite the growing number of loci discovered, the contribution of genetic discoveries, the clinical management of diabetes and obesity remains limited to the small proportion of cases with the monogenic forms of the disease. And 6 years ago now, Nature did a survey of life scientists, and the majority of them were skeptical about how quickly the benefits of genomic medicine were going to come through. More than two-thirds saying it's going to take 10 to 20 years, more than 25% take even longer than that, and 5% didn't even expect to see them, it would happen in their lifetime. It may have just been the older respondents answered that. So why has it all become so fashionable? And I think the main reason is this. It's vested interests. Clearly a huge amount of money and effort and intellectual capital went into the sequencing of the human genome, and it was an obligation to capitalize on that. But also, pharma has switched a lot of their research enterprise into this area, and they've got huge vested interests in producing these fantastic new drugs and selling them. And I think academic departments around the world now have vested interests that are keeping this whole thing alive and driving it along. And there's a colleague of mine who works in public health medicine in Oxford who said to me recently, in Oxford, unless you're in genes, you aren't a real researcher. And certainly I'm aware that in cancer research in the UK, if you're applying for grants, if you haven't got gene or genomic or something like that in the title of your research, it's very unlikely to get funded. But there are huge numbers of questions that still need answering and need funding for research. So, is this really a game changer? And I think this is nothing new and revolutionary. Whole medicine has been based on advances in understanding of basic science, technical developments in diagnostic pathology and imaging, and that's been what we've been building up in medicine for the past 150 years. When my father was a medical student in the 1920s, lung cancer was one condition. When I was studying and when I was practicing, lung cancer was probably 4 or 5 pathological conditions, but actually only 2 conditions when it came to therapy, small cell and non-small cell lung cancer. Now, genomic medicine has told us there are a whole variety, maybe 10 or so different variants of lung cancer, and we also have new drugs to treat them. But again, the outcomes are relatively temporary and short-lived. So, we do have a lot more information about individual patients and their future risk and prognosis. But sometimes making things more complicated is not in the best interest of the patient. We have more complex information to assimilate, and it may be more difficult to make best decisions for patients. So, how does this affect clinical guidelines? Well, you know, again, as with evidence-based medicine, people say, well, personalized medicine, we don't need guidelines. We just have to tailor, use the wonderful algorithms we're hearing about from Digoens to personalize the medicine. I think that's not so. I think we have to, it assumes that knowledge is perfect, and Doug already said that knowledge is imperfect, even in some of the areas he's trying to produce individualized guidelines in. And the outcomes are uncertain. And as I said, things may become more complex, but we still will need guidelines. They need to be well-made, well-validated, tailored to the relevant healthcare system to maximize health gain in the most cost-effective way. When I spoke at the Melbourne GIN conference a couple of years ago, I said that guidelines were power tools and that there was a risk that professional bodies may use guidelines to further their own narrow vested interests. And I think there is a risk of this happening with genomic medicine as well. So I think we still will need guidelines to ensure the most appropriate use of these new diagnostic and prognostic tools and therapies. Just to give you an example, last year I chaired the NICE Melanoma Guideline, and we made a total of 61 recommendations covering diagnosis, staging, treatment, follow-up. But only 5 of these related to genomics in any way. And this is, as I said to you earlier on, a condition in which genomic medicine has made a fantastic breakthrough. So there are still a whole lot of other areas of clinical practice away from the genomic medicine that still need good evidence and good guidelines. And I have a final concern. And I want to quote from Martin Luther King, "Of all the forms of inequality, injustice in healthcare is the most shocking and inhumane." And I think this is a problem with genomic medicine. The tests are expensive and the drugs are expensive, and some of them are horrendously expensive. And overall, as I've explained to you, I think the gains in health are either uncertain or generally not foreseeable in the future as being particularly good. So this is essentially rich person's medicine and unaffordable by many. I was recently in South Africa and I was astonished to find that even private healthcare providers in South Africa have difficulty in getting trastuzumab or Herceptin for breast cancer patients. Now, I'm a child of the NHS, and I have to confess I believe in socialized medicine and that healthcare should be free at the point of delivery and available for all. And I think the modern concepts of personalized medicine, genomic medicine, may arguably be benefiting the wealthy individual ahead of the wider good. So, for me, personalized medicine is nothing new. Genomic medicine is arguably oversold in terms of its immediate and potential benefit. And I think clinical guidelines will continue to have an important role in clinical care and need to put the advances of genomic medicine into the proper context of a balanced healthcare system. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for a very thoughtful presentation. And again, the inequities in healthcare and the issues with personalized medicine, I'd love to have some discussion. And if you want to talk to Fergus about why do we even need guidelines, if you guys remember, we have had that debate at some point as well. He's skeptic, and you can have a really good discussion with Fergus on this.